So what I'm going to tell you is very simple. You can shape artificial intelligence, or artificial intelligence will shape you. I will start with a little bit of history, that's my specialty. You heard a lot about it. I will give you a little different perspective. And then I will tell you a little bit about today's artificial intelligence, and then a little bit about the future. So, artificial intelligence started in 1955. 1956 is when the first conference took place. At the beginning, there were two schools. One school was trying to simulate the mind, how the mind works, and one school was trying to simulate the structure of the brain. So the second one is the neural network. Today you have heard a lot about neural networks. But for a long time, it was the first school that was famous. In fact, even today, people like Marvin Minsky are much more famous than any of the people down here. Today is neural network. So what happened between then and today? Well, I will tell people the number one factor in the progress of AI has been the speed of processor. Computers have been getting faster and faster, cheaper and cheaper, smaller and smaller. That's the difference. Neural networks at the beginning were just not feasible. It would have just the computer power was not there for neural networks. There was theoretical progress during those years, and I want to show you some of these protagonists. Fukushima invented convolutional neural networks in 79. Today, convolutional neural networks are the main method used in recognizing images. And the reinforcement learning, it's a very old theory, but in 1981, we had the first physical algorithm. Then in the 80s, there was also a lot of progress in making neural networks work. And different methods to calculate neural networks. Now, I'm showing you the formula for a reason. Now, I want to show you, I want you to know, to realize that there's a lot of mathematics behind this work. More progress, the neural networks became more sophisticated and, of course, more mathematics. This was an important theorem. It's a mathematical theorem. It shows that neural networks can approximate any function. What does that mean? It means they can do anything. But up until this point, and even later actually, 89 is the first success story of convolutional networks, and in the 90s there's still some evolution. Those long, short memory networks are particularly important today. Up to this point, the computers were still too slow. It was just too difficult to create a neural network. And so the first success stories of artificial intelligence actually don't involve neural networks. In 1994, the first self-driving car drove a long distance near Paris. Yes, the self-driving car is 23 years old. IBM Deep Blue beat Chess Master, Chess Champion. And these were done with relatively old methods, with statistical methods. Sebastian Thrun won the DARPA Challenge, the one I showed you in 2005. He became famous later for the Google car. And you probably heard of IBM Watson that they did in 2011. 2011 is also when Siri came out, and then we had chatbots and so on. But up to this point, actually, they were not using neural networks. They were using different kinds of technology. while they were doing those things with all technology, these gentlemen were inventing deep learning. Today we live in the age of deep learning. And the theory came up in 2006, 2007, two different theories. Hinton and Hangzhou used a slightly different architecture. And it took a few years, but in 2012, that's a little thing that you see there. Actually, that's very important, because every year there was a competition to see if machines can recognize images. In 2012, using Hinton's deep learning, that error rate collapsed. It went down dramatically. So really 2012 is really the year when things changed. I wanted to show you the mathematics, because as I said, I want you to realize that all these words behind them, there's a lot of mathematics. And that mathematics requires a lot of computation. So what they did, if you look at the graph there, it's almost the same curve as the curve of deep learning. Deep learning is born and it's not so popular, then the speed of the machine increases, and then we start using deep learning and we start seeing the results. And that's the CEO of NVIDIA with one of his incredibly fast machines. So 2012 is when you start seeing the headline, the news. Artificial intelligence is in the news. This was a popular, very popular news in 2012 when this collaboration with Stanford and Google produced a system that recognized cats on video. And in 2013, scientist in Switzerland designed a system that recognizes handwriting, Chinese handwriting, almost as well as a human being. And so after that, you know what happens after that. There's a new, every year there's some new achievement of artificial intelligence. So it really started theoretically in 2006, but in practice in 2012, the machines became powerful enough. This is just curiosity. I wrote down the name, the protagonist for deep learning, the people who really developed deep learning as it is today. And one day I started realizing that none of them is actually born in the United States. And this is just a curiosity, do what you like with it. But it's interesting that we're all born in different countries. Most of them work in the United States. Actually, most of them work in the Silicon Valley. But they were not born there, which is interesting. So, that's what happened, you know, after 2012. This is investment by big corporations. And look at the date. Almost all of the investment starts from 2012. That's the magical year. And I was tired of updating this slide, because every few months there's a new major investment in a startup. So Venture Scanner says there are now 1,600 startups in AI. When I was doing AI in the 80s, it was almost the best word. And now there are 1,600 stars. Okay. Now, let's come to today, to research going on today. And I want to talk about seven technologies, and then I will talk more about robots. The names are complicated. Unfortunately, artificial intelligence scientists are not good at picking names. but the technologies are very interesting. These are things that are happening today. The first one, reinforcement learning, you actually know it well, very well. It's actually very popular because of the success of one lab, DeepMind, in England, which is now owned by Google. It started in 2003 when they developed this new technique, and originally they used it to to play Atari games, and the machine got better than the average player at playing Atari video games. And then the other people started using it, reinforcement learning, to play Wei Qi. And since 2009, there were success stories of machines beating human and Wei Qi. But of course, when Google does it, then everybody knows about it. So you know about AlphaGo, and AlphaGo uses reinforcement learning. It's one of the technologies that made it possible. And today, reinforcement learning is one of the main lines of research, precisely because it's been so successful in Wei Qi. Another technology that is becoming very popular is recurrent neural nets. What does it do? Well, these are neural networks used to guess what is happening next. So you have a sequence, and the neural network tries to guess what is the next thing in the sequence. Practical application, language. You have a sentence, there's a word if, what could be next? And the neural network gets maybe the word fun. And then they realize that you can use the same technology to do machine translation. So machine translation also, you have to get what is the next word if you are translating from English to Chinese, for example. And then they realize the same technology can be used to recognize images, because recognizing an image is basically translating the picture into words. Of course, it's not so simple, but you know that's the power of this new kind of neural network. It can be used in multiple areas, and precisely the areas that were considered very, very, very difficult. And similar research is going on at Stanford. Google posted this feature on their blog. I think it's still there. This was very interesting. This was in the 2014 paper that shocked the world. Machines so good at recognizing a scene, not just an image. Recognizing an apple, a bottle, is difficult enough. But this, we're talking about recognizing a scene. Now, look at this one, for example. It's recognizing a group of young people playing frog, frisbee. You can barely see the frisbee, just a little white thing. So the machine did an amazing job. Two dogs playing in the grass. Well, there's three dogs. But it's pretty impressive that they recognize dogs, not cats, not deer. But I want you to focus on one of these images. It's down there. And usually these are the images they never show you. So that image is a street sign. The machine said this is a refrigerator filled with lots of food and drink. So I want to remember this one. We'll discuss it later. Of course, progress in speech recognition for the same reason. Now they are using this new neural network. Next, this is the third and last one with difficult names. We could just call it GAN. What's new about this network? This is very recent. The first paper came out in 2014, then it was refined in 2015, and just the last few months we have the first impressive results. These are two networks. Basically, you can think of the good neural network and the evil neural network, and they are competing. The good one is trying to recognize an image. The bad one is trying to fool, to confuse the good one. And this is a way to train the good one very rapidly. Okay? The interesting thing is that the evil one generates images. If you look at those images, let me small, but don't look like objects in a house. Well, those images were invented by the neural network. So neural networks became very good over the last 2 years at recognizing. But we humans do something else. We can also generate an image. If I ask you to draw a dog, you would go for legs, tail, ear. You know what is a dog, that's why. Just saying that's a dog, that's a dog, that's a dog, that's a dog, that's not enough. You understand what a dog is when you can actually just draw one that doesn't exist. Okay, I'm really bad, so my dog will look horrible, but I know what a dog is. So this is a case in which a machine decides, okay, this is a bat, and the machine creates the image of the bat. So that's an important step forward in understanding what an object is. No, I have a bigger picture. These images are not real. They are made by the machine to confuse another neural network. So conceptually, that's very good. Okay, I'm finished with the three difficult ones. Now, the seven things I wanted to tell you. Number four, those three things are difficult. They are very difficult, even for the specialist. It takes very skilled mathematicians working weeks and weeks to tweak, refine those networks. Luckily, now we have software, most of it available for free, that helps software engineers design those networks. And that's important. That's why we have so many startups. Those 1,600 startups don't have to write everything from zero. They can start with this platform that gives them bigger help. And of course, when Google does it, everybody talks about it. So just, these are very recent features from Google that made available this platform to develop deep learning applications. And the same is true of chatbots. building a chatbot is complicated, but now you have a platform for natural language processing and platform for conversation. So you can build your own chatbot with this platform. That's a big help to start in artificial intelligence. And some of these are free. More help is coming because machine learning is so complicated. The scientists started thinking, why don't we develop a machine that can learn how to do machine learning? A machine learning for machine learning. So that the machine automatically designs the neural network for you. And so these are very experimental projects, but the concept is interesting, right? I tell the machine what I need, and the machine will design the neural network for me. And this whole conference will be useless because the machine will do everything. Well, we're not there, but these are projects in the world that are going there. So that's in Canada, that's in Germany. This is in the United States, and of course, when Google does it, then everybody knows about it. So this is a Google project just announced a few weeks ago, I think last month, for automatic machine learning. So between the platform and this, the field will probably become easier in the next few years. Oops, did I go too fast? Okay, robots. Now, robots is a longer story. And I know robots are particularly popular in China. Of course, we have robots in many places. We have robots in shopping centers. These are recent robots, pictures taken in California. And we are beginning to see the domestic robots. I don't want to publish my Toyota, but I must admit that Toyota was one of the first companies to think of the robots for the house. And it is interesting that Rovina, that came out in 2007, 10 years ago, now is being targeted as a nursing robot, a robot for elderly people in hospitals. And of course, we have robots in warehouses, not for startups in this field, and robots for potential jobs. There are two areas where we need to do more research and where progress has been very slow. So they always show you the video where the robots can run. They don't show you the video where 99% of the robots actually fall. So one is walking robots. Been a lot of progress since the old days, but you saw my video. And so walking is complicated. You have to plan the trajectory, and then you have to make the right movement. It's a very complicated problem. And then thrusting, another weak point of robots, when they have to grasp something, they have to understand the shape of the object, and you know, strength, the composition, and the problem. Before I go into more detail, everybody asks me, well, the robots are going to steal all the jobs. I'm not an economist, but I just don't see that in the statistics. This is a recent number of robots in a different country. These are the countries that have the most robots. And then I have found these statistics about unemployment in each continent. If you look at Europe, the country with the lowest unemployment is Germany, that has the highest death in Europe. In the Americas, the United States and Canada have the lowest unemployment, the highest death in Europe. In Asia, Japan and Korea have the highest density of robots, the lowest unemployment. So I'm not an economist, but I just don't see this destruction of jobs by the robots, but I see the opposite. Now, one funny thing about deep learning is that we don't really understand how it works. We know that if you try hard enough, we make the neural network do amazing things. But we don't really understand how it does it. And so this is somebody who's trying to come up with ways to look inside the neural network. And the United States government has a specific project to try to explain neural networks. Now, remember, neural networks used to be two layers, but now there are many layers. So what happens in between is almost impossible to guess. So the next step is that machines surprise us. They surprise us because we don't understand how they work. And so they started making art. Somebody at Oxford had the idea to ask the neural network what's going on, and the neural network started printing these images as the original paper. And so that's kind of fascinating, that when the neural network is trying to learn something, recognize something, it actually has an internal representation that looks like art, you know, modern art. These are the original papers. As usual, when Google does it, everybody talks about it. So eventually somebody at Google, I believe in terms of Europe, European office, Google, did the same thing, and these images became very popular, and there was even an auction of this art in San Francisco, I believe exactly 1 year ago, 1 year, 2 months. This is actually even more impressive. That's a real painting by a Russian artist, Leonid Abramov. So Leon Gamis, he's German, trained the neural network to recognize this type. And then he showed the image from the real building to the neural network. And the neural network painted the building in the style of this painter. It's almost like neural network understood the style of this painter. And you know, probably know in China they published a book, horrible poem I hear, but still. And just last week I organized this event in Silicon Valley called Laser, where I put together artists and scientists. And this is Maya Ackerman of San Jose State University. She's performing music that was composed by two machine learning systems. NAPLE is a system, actually, let me say, NAPLE, with it. Anyway, it's a system that generates lyrics. And Aliza is a system that generates the music for those lyrics. So she's singing a song composed by these two artificial intelligence. Anyway, that's just for fun. And also we had the first international beauty contest that was judged by artificial intelligence, and these were the winners picked by the machine. I'm not sure I would have picked the same winner. So, of course, now it's getting scary. I mean, we don't understand how the neural networks work, and neural networks are even making art to be creative. So, not surprising that some people, much more intelligent people than me, got afraid of what artificial intelligence can do. So we just had a conference, the Asilomar conference, where they discussed, all these people down there, discussed how can we make sure that artificial intelligence will do good things, not bad things. And of course, Kurzweil became famous talking about the singularity that was supposed to come for 5 years. I think it changes the date. Okay, so what's the future in my opinion? I'll give you some ideas. First of all, if you read my book, we discussed 10 technologies, not just one. And my personal opinion, when they asked me to do this slide, I did not put artificial intelligence as the number one disruptive technology. I personally think that there are other technologies that are going to be more disruptive, at least in the next few years. And same when they asked me to do a slide for business technology, my opinion is that there are other technologies that are coming and will have an impact, business impact, bigger. So, read the book, you will find out why. But today we're talking about artificial intelligence. So, first of all, vanity. In 2015, I don't like to say prediction. I like to use the word hope. In 2015, my hope was this one. This was 3 years. 3 years ago, I gave a talk on artificial intelligence, and I said, I hope that we can invent, that we can use deep learning to recognize medical images and analyze them, because we have hundreds of millions of medical images. They contain important information. Nobody's looking at them. When they take an x-ray, they put in a file. I want deep learning to scan these images all the time, based on very recent scientific knowledge, and see if there is some important information for you. So this was a slide I made 3 years ago, and as you know, now, guess what, 3 years later, everybody's talking about it. And in particular, I want to mention these two projects. I still think the university is ahead of operation. So the first one is at Stanford. The picture is of Sebastian Thrun, the same guy who did the self-driving car. His team showed the system that can recognize the skin cancer. It's one of the most common cancers in the world. And that one was in England, two or 3 weeks later. A deep learning system that can predict a heart attack. If this system works, they can save the lives of millions of people. So I'm very happy that my prediction, my hope, came true in just 2 years. So what is my hope for 2017? What's the next goal that I set for artificial intelligence? It's not easy to describe, but there are things in the world that we call wicked problems, or sometimes we just call them mess. Okay, a mess is climate change. A mess is actually anything in the world, including Hangzhou, because it's complicated, okay? And nobody really knows how to solve these problems, because they are so complicated. This is my friend Bob Ford, who spent his life analyzing messes, and he makes this beautiful diagram. You can find more on his website. So I want artificial intelligence to help us solve messes. These are the big problems that the world is facing in the near future. Now, robotics. I missed one. One slide is missing, I will just tell you. So, the progress in robots at different levels. The simple level is that we're building robots that begin to move, they begin to grasp, and so forth. The number one application, in my opinion, in the near future, is going to be robots for elderly people. Japan is ahead of this. Why? Because Japan has an aging population, rapidly aging population. And so, but I think this is something we need in many countries of the world. The self-driving car can work only in very structured environments. But kits to improve cars, that's real. And that's coming, and I think eventually I will see it in every car. Every car has become very safe. Now, by the way, we have done the same thing with airplanes. The most complex robot in the world is the airplane that I took 2 days ago from San Francisco to Hangzhou. Those big planes are all fully automated. They're robots. Very big, very expensive robots. But there's still a pilot and a co-pilot, right? There are at least two pilots in that plane that control what's going on. So same in the car. I just want the car to become more intelligent, not necessarily self-driving. Then we see more and more experiments with robots that self-organize. What does it mean? For example, the Harvard robot, the first picture, they are trained to build something, and they work together like ants, work together to achieve that goal, to build something. This was an idea that came out in 2010, and it failed, but I still think it's a good idea. The idea was very simple. Put a robot on wheels, and you have put a smartphone on wheels, and you have a robot. Why? Because this is what robot intelligence looks like. Okay? Okay, you need to have dexterity, and you need to walk. That's it. But that's difficult in general. Then you need wireless networking, cloud robotics, big data, machine learning, object recognition, speech recognition. But these things are on your smartphone. You just download the app. So somebody has a great idea to say a smartphone already contains the intelligence of a robot. So I think that was a great idea, and I expect that somebody will do something with this idea. Now the cloud is what can make robots a lot more intelligent very quickly. Because the cloud is where robots can share knowledge. And so these are the pioneers of cloud robotics. And there's a number of reasons why. But in Europe, there's already two major clouds that robot inventors, anybody, can use to share knowledge. So what one robot learns, another robot can apply. basically they're building the Wikipedia for robots. Now, my friend Ken Goldberg at UC Berkeley is doing something interesting. Unfortunately, I couldn't get me the video for this. He is training robots in virtual reality. So he's using the cloud and virtual reality to train the robot. What's the advantage? The advantage is that he can train robots all night long. It generates objects in virtual reality, and then he asks the robot to grasp it in virtual reality. And in this way, you can train robots much faster. He's brand new. You can Google Ken Goldberg. And you will see his very recent interview. And then that way that we are making robots more and more able to learn by themselves. If you Google Million Object Challenge, that's one of the most interesting projects right now. So, all of these trends for robots. But I actually want to talk more about the invisible robot. What do I mean by invisible robot? Well, as you know, we live in the age of data, right? Everything is data. Deep learning needs large databases, otherwise it doesn't work. And large databases need deep learning. So there's a symbiosis there between big data and deep learning. And so what's happening is that we have increasingly good machine learning systems that can recognize what you are doing. Well, they basically study your digital behavior, they basically study your mind. The machine knows more about you than your best friend. And the machine has more data about everybody else than you. The machine is really that knows you very well, it knows everybody very well. So the machine can actually control your behavior. It's spying on you all the time and can control your behavior. The invisible robot can design your behavior. And this is definitely, when you buy something, you know, the invisible robot is already working on your mind. So this will have a number of applications. And the scary thing, there will be thousands of these invisible robots trying to influence your mind. So that's the thing that scares people. The positive side is that these invisible robots are fair. See, I'm influenced. I have friends. I have a brother. A robot, once it's programmed to do something, it's fair. So it will have a judge who is absolutely fair. So it can go good or bad. This story of the invisible robot. And that's why I talk about the behavior designer, the engineer of the future. It will not just be designing the robot, but you have to design the robot in a way that designs behavior. And you are the designer. Now, to design the robot that you want, you have to speak the language of the invisible robot. And now you see why I kept showing the mathematics. If you want to speak the language of this machine, you have to speak that language. So when young people ask me, what should I study? So you want to be the one who shapes the eye, not the one who shapes my eye. Now, I showed the video to you. Okay? How real is this? How soon is coming? Well, machines work very well only in very structured environments. We structure the environment, then the machine works very well. Recognizing that a cat is great, but any mouse can recognize the cat. this friend at NASA told me that the most sophisticated robot in 2013 did in 200 days what the NASA scientists can do in one afternoon. Alcohol, great scientific experiment. But I did a little calculation. AlphaGo used 440,000 watts of power. Your brain uses 20 watts. AlphaGo uses 440,000 watts to do one thing, play Wei Qi. Your brain uses 20 watts to do a lot of things, including listening to me. So, you know, there is progress, but put it in context. Deep learning works only if you have a large data set. Okay? If you look at the timeline of AI, it's impressive. First, somebody built a huge data set of chess games. Then, a machine, Deep Blue, became very good at chess. And this is the story. Somebody built a huge data set, then the machine does something very well. All the way to AlphaGo. So, first, somebody has built a large data set, and it has to explain what those data mean. Then the machine can be trained. Today's AI uses a lot of very old technology, actually. This is a paper published a few weeks ago by OpenAI. And it says, they say, not me, techniques that have been known for decades. We are still using very old artificial intelligence. What has changed? The power of computers. Okay? So, now back to the picture I showed you there. The machine recognized that sign as a refrigerator. How can they make such a big mistake? Common sense. Machines don't have common sense. This is common sense. This happened last year in England. A group of children were trying to help the police. The police was on a helicopter looking for some criminals. The criminals were running away. The police was in a helicopter. How do you help the police? Children, nobody told them. They formed an arrow on the ground. Why? The police is on a helicopter. They cannot hear you, but they can see you. What's the symbol to tell the police where to go? The arrow. Okay? Nobody told the children to do it. Common sense. The children did it spontaneously. A machine cannot do that. A machine does what you train the machine to do. So that's what is still missing in machines. The big thing that is missing is common sense, and research is failing there. We're still very far from any machine. That's why machine makes that mistake. You know, a refrigerator? It's not a refrigerator. Obviously. Because it's not a house. It's not a kitchen. Okay? Now, people ask me, so where's the next big breakthrough, next progress coming from? The brain. Convolutional network, reinforcement learning, they all came from the study of the human brain. So these initiatives are very important. These are examples. You know, these are big national or international projects. They gave us great progress in some fields. And the next one is going to be in the brain. So there was the inauguration of the brain project in 2013 by Barack Obama. And this is where you're going to have progress in artificial intelligence. Because I think that studying the human brain, we learn things that today we just don't know. The human brain obviously works much better than the machine. We can do with 20 watts what the machine cannot do with 440,000 watts. We still have to understand that thing. So we need AI soon. I told you, but now you understand this. I mean, artificial intelligence is a great promise, but there's other technologies that are coming very soon, and they have business opportunities. So, is the singularity really near? Well, we still need a lot of research to do. That's me on the hike in California. We can work with the robot. And just remember, you know, machines can do a lot of things, but you are the designer. So you decide where the machine is going. Thank you, President Zhu. Thank you, Piero.
Thank you, Piero. Thank you, Piero.